Okay.
You're good there.
Lisa, should I take off?
I'm going to cross over.
Yeah, I'm going to cross over.
Are you crossing back?
So how did you become a whale person?
I don't even know if I would characterize myself yet as a whale person. It would be an honor to be characterized as that. But there are so many people that precede me, and there's just, I'm sort of standing on their shoulders and you know, reaping the benefits of their research. But I took my kids to SeaWorld before I made this movie. So I'm one of those people. So in 2 years, I learned what I know now. I mean, I learned, I sort of entered the movie via Tillicum and what he did to Dawn. That was kind of my entry point. Uh-huh. You know, and my question was, how did this happen? Why would this have happened? Aren't these animals incredibly intelligent? And if so, why would it bite the hand that feeds it? Why would it sort of bite? You know, you hear about pit bulls mauling other people. You don't hear about them turning on their masters. So in my mind, why would this whale make this decision? That was my question. My question wasn't, SeaWorld must be horrible. So I entered him with that, and the more I peeled back the onion, I just became more and more shocked.
So what did entering into that mean for you? I mean, is it, I'm looking for something to do? I'm looking for the right movie to make?
No, I mean, I'm a documentary filmmaker, so I always have a question, right? You always have, you enter with sort of a burning question. Mm-hmm. And you know, you hope that there's a story behind there that you're able to tell powerfully and passionately or whatever.
So you just hear about this in the news, as everybody else did, and then say, okay, this may be a subject worth exploring?
That's exactly how it went. I just said, this is a question mark. This is true documentary filmmaking because I'm learning as I go. I have no idea what the trajectory is. And in fact, I thought the trajectory of the documentary would be something completely different. I thought I'd be like discovering, you know, exploring this grand, the grand themes of, you know, people who own animals and, you know, humans and our animal counterparts. Mm-hmm. And this grand discussion, hearing all sides. And as soon as I kind of entered into this world and started hearing some of the answers to my question, I was like, oh, this is a completely different film. And I'm just going to have to sort of let it take me where it needs to.
And how did you find the people who kind of took you along in that ride? I mean, it seems like the group that you found who were interviewed during the movie, and I mean, a lot of people who used to work at SeaWorld and parks like that.
Yeah.
It seems like they almost already had like a group. They almost suddenly had their own self-help group.
They had a, yeah, it does seem like that. They had a group. They had sort of found each other. Some of them had worked together and they had overlapped a bit, but they really actually sort of found each other after Dawn's death and realized, okay, you know, I probably have to speak out. Some of them like just sort of didn't have closure on those years, you know, and just some of them feel guilty. Dean Gummersall just still sort of like does the animal rehab and rescue business himself to almost sort of cleanse, you know, the ills that he feels like he did. I mean, I think he says, I've forgiven myself. And,
well, and like a couple of them. The Cove, who was the trainer at
a little bit similar to that.
With Flipper.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
Does is this, yeah.
That's right. Rick O'Berry. That, you know, you just sort of, you know, spend the rest of your life trying to make up for that. Mm. So, you know, I don't know that's exact. I've heard Dean say that, you know, I've sort of forgiven myself. And a couple of the others, just new information, and they are hearing spin on the news. And they were like, oh, that's just not true. Like, it's simply not true. It's not even a half truth. And so they kind of joined forces and came forth and spoke in the media. Mm-hmm. And so I knew that they were out there, but, you know, they were all terrified. It's not easy to be a whistleblower, I think, you know, and even though a lot of them were out of SeaWorld when they blew the whistle, a couple of them weren't.
Right.
And those that were out were still terrified because they were afraid their former employers would see them as upstarts, you know, and, oh, wow, this guy blew a whistle on this, you know, what,
well, it's not like this past range employer. Of places you can be a whale trainer.
No, that's right. You know, that's right. Oh, they're just—they're so happy in their lives and so excited to have careers past, you know, after SeaWorld, that they were afraid to mess it up by being little rebels and by being seen as rebels. So they were just like, and everybody's still terrified of SeaWorld. It's so strange having worked there. The folks who have worked there, just say, you know, we know these people have a lot of money and they will do everything to protect that park.
So did you approach SeaWorld from the very beginning? Was that a...
They were always part of the documentary, in my mind. They were always, I would never have not tried to contact them because, as I said, I didn't have an agenda. I needed to hear from them. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I thought I would have heard, you know, more revealing information from them probably than anybody else, mm-hmm. since it's their park. So I tried and I tried, and they told me they were very interested for about, I think, 6 months. Mm-hmm. They would just sort of say, yeah, no, we're still just sort of reviewing and just, you know, seeing what's going on. And yeah, little
bit. So because they were waiting for you to show your hand as to who you were going to be associated with?
Or? Perhaps. They definitely asked who, you know, who our distributor was. We didn't have one. Uh-huh. Who our investors were, who and who we had interviewed. They were very interested in that and what the slant was and all this stuff. And I was very, at that point, I was very forthcoming. I was like, I have certainly interviewed more of critics of your park, mm-hmm. than I have supporters, but that's why I'm calling you. You know, I want you to have a voice in this. Mm-hmm. And they said no. Eventually they said no. So
was there a moment where you felt the veil of silence come down and that they were just never going to participate and could be working against you quietly somewhere in the background? Or
people told me that. People told me, don't be fooled. They're pretending to say maybe, but they've said no a long time ago. There's nothing they can gain, mm-hmm. from this. And when I started looking at the evidence, I realized that there probably wasn't. I could understand why they wouldn't want to be interviewed. They would have had to be prepared to answer a lot of questions, I think, that maybe, you know, are not that PR friendly.
Well, being on the defensive is never a PR friendly
position. I think that's true. You know, I would hope to not come off as that kind of interviewer, but I think the evidence that I would have to bring up, just by nature of the evidence, why was a great trainer killed at your park, is already, you know, setting them up for
a fault. It was her
fault,
obviously, so. According to the movie, according to the story they told.
Right, that's right, yeah.
So it's kind of hard to stick with that over and over again.
That's right.
It's like taking the fifth or something.
Yeah, you know, that freaking ponytail. How dare she, you know?
Good. Yeah. So as you got into it, did you find that, I mean, obviously there's an entire universe of this issue with whales and parks and everything else.
Yeah.
And the movie kind of focuses primarily on the direct threat to people and to trainers in particular, by the whales.
Right.
Was that a choice you made as you got into it, or was that something that's just a thing you decided, okay, this is, we should narrow cast a little bit and find that focus, or?
In terms of the danger to the trainers, kind of?
Was what the choice of what the focus of the film would be. I mean, you could have, as I said, there were people who are very much into the issue of the size of the cages and their swimming.
I hear exactly what you're saying.
You brought up the swimming thing, the 100 miles a day kind of thing.
Sure, sure. I guess I felt, because, you know, I was a SeaWorld goer, mm-hmm. and the types of things that sort of, what slapped me in the face was a trainer death. I hate to say that. That's embarrassing for me to admit that I had not read about, you know, the ills of captivity or anything like that, mm-hmm. that it took a person dying for me to wake up. But if I truly believe that if that had that effect on me, mm-hmm. that might have an effect on all the other people that take their kids to SeaWorld, you know, and who kind of rush to it as this iconic symbol of happy Shamu, mm-hmm. and don't know really, might feel kind of weird about it. It's kind of, these shows are a little weird, they don't feel right, but still go there.
Right.
So anyway, I felt if a trainer death was enough to jar me out of my malaise, anesthetic state, whatever it was that I was in.
Well, there are millions of dollars going into keeping you in that malaise. I mean,
they're
working hard to make you think that way.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So I think I guess I felt if I was jarred by that, other people would listen. Hey, this is not, you know, yes, the animals are not happy, but the trainers are also not safe. Mm-hmm. It's about animals and people and sort of, you know.
Yeah, because when you see it in the film, you know, at one point, I think it's maybe the OSHA report has pages and pages of, you know, 80-something or more than that, actual incidents of significance.
Yeah, yeah. And it's funny because the trainers don't feel sorry for themselves, and they don't feel sorry necessarily for one another. They know they made a choice to take mm-hmm. that job. And so, you know, but one thing that was so powerful for me is that, is, you know, once they're in there, they fall in love with their animal. Mm-hmm. So it's truly, you know, this intelligent animal that they have a connection with. And that is a very powerful tool for, you know, a corporation to be able to use. Like, mm-hmm. if you don't play by the rules, we'll move you to Sea Lion and Otter. We'll take you, we'll fire you. You will never
know. Just the phrase will move you to Sea Lion and Otter itself.
Just the strangest phrase in the world. Yeah. I know. But the leverage that they have, they can use your love to sort of leverage it, you know, and just sort of say, behave, or you'll get moved to another park. You'll get moved to, or you'll get fired. So you will never know that your whale is being taken care of as mm-hmm. well ever again. I mean, that's, I don't even know what you call that, you know, in
emotional
labor rights. Emotional blackmail?
I'm not sure it qualifies in labor rights. Parental rights, I think.
Parental right, right, that's right. That's
more of
right.
a parent trick than a labor trick.
That it seems like it just hits at a different level, and I don't even know what to make of that. I don't know if there's a legal term for that.
Well, trainer after trainer, you know, you could see them talking about the whale they loved.
Right.
Particularly, and the
right.
connection, and, you know, giving up that connection being so significant.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's the thing that tears them up the most, you know, is thinking back on the animal they had to leave.
Well, there's definitely a grizzly man element to it all. Cause,
I like that comparison.
Well, I think it's interesting that because of the way we've all been brainwashed, or at least, you know, refocused by the advertisements and everything else, the idea of there being parks.
Right.
Because there really aren't grizzly bear parks.
Right.
So
right.
Timothy Treadwell seems insane for thinking he has a connection to a
That's
bear.
Right. That's right.
But here these people feel like they have a connection to a, you know, equally dangerous, if not more dangerous, wild animal.
That's right. Oh, a much more dangerous wild animal, you know? Yeah, and, you know, it's really hard because it's, I don't know that they don't have mm-hmm. that connection, you know? In the same way that, you know, you really don't know if Timothy Treadwell was sort of like, you know?
Right.
You don't know. He certainly seemed, you know, more rogue, mm-hmm. you know? But I can't say to this day, and neither can any of the trainers. I mean, I know they are coached, you know? No, we're not coached, but I know that they are trying very hard not to say that, you know, that animal loved me back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all you know is what you feel, but everything else is blank. And, you know, you're not really, you're thinking you're hearing something back,
mm-hmm.
and you're not. And that's, like, the hardest thing to come to terms with, because we think our dogs love us back, and we think that's love, and we don't know, we don't even know, because dogs have been domesticated for so many years, if that really is food. You know, mm-hmm. and the promise of food in the future. And so it's so hard. Like, is this feeling really love, you know? Or am I getting loved back? It's like, you just have to at some point be comfortable with the fact that you don't really know, you know?
And of course, there's the great rationalization that, you know, if your 3-year-old had the, you know, was twice as powerful as you are, and had a tantrum,
right.
you could break your arm.
That's you know? Exactly,
because you didn't give them the Fruit Loops.
That's exactly
or whatever,
it.
And that's
right, right. You know. And that's the most disconcerting. It feels like the opposite of love. Mm-hmm. You know, the obviously what, you know, this behavior, a Kasatka pulling Ken Peters down. Wow, you know, she almost killed him, but you know. When you hear later his, you know, when you read his testimony, he's just sort of said, she made the choice to let me go because mm-hmm. of our relationship, you know, and SeaWorld's very excited about that because then it shows that their training works. And if you are a good enough skilled trainer, mm-hmm. you can get yourself out of those situations. But then we see the Dawn situation. There was no getting out of it. There
so
was nothing
when the whale
do.
Takes you down for a minute and a half and almost kills you, but decides to let you go after taking you down 4 or 5 times,
right.
then it's because it's love.
yeah, right. That's right.
On the way down the first 3-4 times, it was something else.
No, that's right. And if I were in there, since I can't hold my breath or ventilate or be taken down like that, she would have known that and just been like, oh, this one, I got a weak one. I'm going to let her up a little earlier because, you know, but, you know, still love. But, yeah, I mean, it's a little bit... It starts getting very gray area.
Well, they have the Orca iPhone where they have the little timer on it. This is how much air a human being has before we kill them.
Right, that's right.
So the footage on something like that, for instance, which is amazing footage, there's that whole sequence where we see this happening over and over again and watch him aerate himself and the guy who survived it. And it's kind of amazing. Is that actually seemed like in-house footage, almost, or professional footage? It didn't seem like...
Oh, it's in-house. It's in-house.
So you ended up finding a way to have a mixture of... flip cams and
correct
and cell phones and actual
correct.
Footage that came from in-house?
Yep. We did. We managed to get our hands on so many different angles and formats and things, and that was a treasure trove. It was, you know, some of it we fought very hard to get. Mm-hmm. Perseverance is everything in documentary, you know, and convincing people who had the film, you know, as well. Mm-hmm. That I'm not this sort of fly-by-night, quick story, you know, I'm in and out, I just want to sensationalize it on YouTube, like, I want to tell this in context, this is a proper documentary, and we hope to sort of educate and actually tell the story, rather than show footage, you know? It came from a lot of different places.
But when the secret employee from SeaWorld who snuck into last night's screening, sitting there with a hat and a, you know, said Disneyland on it.
Maybe you would know. Yeah, you would know best. I don't know if those things happen, but they
must.
They
do. They definitely happen. But when they send the report back, will they be thinking, okay, maybe we're considering a lawsuit? Or, I mean, will they consider some of that footage their footage that is not supposed to be out there?
I cannot imagine that. I can't imagine. I didn't get anything unlawfully. Right. I didn't do anything illegal or anything unlawful. Everything was fair. Everything's honest.
I think everything's fair also. I'm just saying.
Right.
They may
would
not,
they
you
think,
know, if it came off of one of their cameras.
Don't know how they work. Yeah. You know, I don't know how they work. I don't know.
You may
know.
Have more relationship with them now.
Right, exactly. Now I can learn and tell you in an interview when I'm in my orange jumpsuit, I can be interviewed and you can tell me.
It was a big fair use year here at the festival because there's also a movie apparently that was shot in Disneyland with a, you know, home camera or whatever.
Yeah, I sat by him on the bus and we were like, oh, are we in really deep shit? We have no idea. We have no idea. It's anybody's guess. But we were both in the same New York Times article, just cracking up. Like,
there you go.
So what I prefer orange for a jumpsuit, but maybe he likes kind of that green. I don't know.
Just don't go see the Pussy Riot movie and you'll be okay.
Yeah, oh my
gosh. That'll scare you.
That's right. The three rebels.
It's becoming a theme.
Right. Fair use is huge.
Yeah.
It saves us.
So you found the footage somehow.
Right.
And it all came, and was finding the kind of homemade footage, is it all on YouTube, and that's how you found it?
There's a lot of Freedom of Information Act as well for some of the footage. So I would FOIA.
So like when OSHA would do their thing and investigate, you could get access to the materials for Freedom of Information?
Yeah, it wasn't quite that easy, you know, because they're in litigation, all this stuff, but, you know, there are ways, if you persevere, that you can get your hands on information when you need it. And, you know, it's there for you. I mean, they can, people can delay administratively. It cannot get into your hands until your movie's long gone.
Right.
So it's incredibly difficult, but there's certainly legal routes to all of this. So aside from fair use, you know.
And so in terms of how you crafted the film, in terms of the structure of it, did you have more and decide to do less? Did you have other stories that you wanted to tell and just?
I couldn't even, it's a 20-hour movie. The discipline to just stick with this narrative was like that was my biggest challenge by far. That and interviewing, you know, family members, you know, who of trainers who had died. But yeah, one of my biggest challenges was just not shoehorning every little piece of information about what happens to these whales in parks or about captivity or about all this stuff. I mean, it's really powerful stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Some other movies have touched upon it in a much more comprehensive and better way than I do in this. But I felt so strongly that I had to pick my story and to tell the story and not try to do stuff to get you to take a stand or try to get you to hate SeaWorld or try, you know, I couldn't shoehorn all that information in.
Mm.
When I found myself doing it, the movie felt like a rant. It felt like I was telling you what to feel. So I just held back and said, you know what? It's amazing information. It's not for this movie, for this narrative.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just had to trust that just stick with the truth, stick with the facts, tell the story tightly, neatly, and you have a chance of hitting new people, I think, that haven't been hit before by this subject. So
last night as you premiered your movie, the first people you thanked were your exec producers.
Yes.
What is that relationship? We didn't get too far into it in the conversation last night, but are they activist-minded or are they documentary-minded?
In fact, I should lengthen that part of my thank you because they were somewhat like me. So they know activism, no history of activism, had never made a movie before, and were interested in making a movie and were brought, you know, put in touch with me.
Mm-hmm.
And I just said, here's a movie I've wanted to make. And I wrote this terrible like PowerPoint. It's really like ugly treatment, just like embarrassment. But I was just like, here it is. And they read it and said, it's fascinating. We also now have that question. Why was Don Brancho killed by Tillicum? And if we have that question to, you know, housewives, you know, why wouldn't everybody else?
And is that who they are? Are they the wives of the prolific dentists who fund every movie at Sundance?
No, they are just, they're two just fantastic women who, one's in Florida, one's in LA, and they've been friends forever, and they came to a point in their careers where they said, we want to make a movie, we want to form a production company, and make a powerful movie that people want to watch. No agenda, no idea what. I think they wanted a female sort of theme, you know, theme to it. Mm-hmm. And that was it.
And I was like, female theme.
Yeah, some sort of, you know, I think that was sort of one of the directives really early on, but I was like, well,
I'm female.
yeah, there's some sort of, you know, I think Tillicum is actually more a larger character in the film than Don Brancho, but they were fascinated, I think, by just reading the treatment. And so they thought, if we're fascinated, let's see what this crazy girl can do with this.
Well, I guess the angle in is that it's, you know, parents, and in particular a mother in your case, taking your kids to SeaWorld.
Right.
And that, you know, that specific perspective seems to be where this whole thing was driven by.
I think so, too.
Yeah, so they must be thrilled.
They are thrilled. Yeah, I think we're all sort of overwhelmed, you know? I mean, it's very, very thrilling. And
I'm pretty sure you opened last night in the same spot as The Interrupters last year.
Oh, really?
Which I think was the best documentary of the last couple, like 2 years ago, I guess now.
Oh, really?
But one of the best documentaries of the last decade. So
oh, wow.
It's a good slot.
Oh, okay. Oh, wow. That's excellent.
Yeah, out of the temple.
Good. At the temple. All right. That's good to know.
So did they come out with you?
Did the executive producer?
Your executive producer?
Did they come out to film and stuff?
To Sundance.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're there in the audience. I know, I'm going to bring them up to the Q&A. I forgot.
But are they having fun? I mean, is it kind of like a...
Yeah.
Celebration of having gotten through this and made this film, or
yeah, I think that they're absolutely thrilled. We're so thrilled. I think it's deer in the headlights a little bit. You know, there's always you never know what's going to happen. You know, you never just navigating Sundance itself and trying to figure out. You know, like, is this really happening? I mean, I still wake up just like, oh, it's just a dream. Oh no, I'm really at Sundance.
So when did you finish your film?
October. I think we did one last shoot.
So you weren't sweating it out to the last second to get that.
Oh well, that was shooting. I mean,
we were
cutting while we were shooting. Yeah, yeah, no question. We were barely made the deadline. It was so ugly. Yeah.
But really thrilling to get that phone call, I guess. Do you carry?
I pulled over the side of the road. Yeah.
Do you carry any of those expectations with you when you go into something? I mean, you're thinking, okay, we're going to head to Sundance. We're going to go to.
No, because I've been rejected by Sundance, so I carry that one. I carry that one deep. No, I think no way. You can't. And you tell other people. Like, I remember just being kind of weirdly annoyed anytime anyone would say, "Oh, well, you know, if it gets into Sundance, da da da," you know, I'd be like, "Ugh." The karma, you're just destroying it. Like, it's never going to happen. And I just said it has nothing to do with, you know, if we can have a great film and it cannot get into Sundance because nobody gets into Sundance. So that was sort of just my mantra. And I just said, let's just make a great film. And just, that's it. Let's just make a great film, focus on that. So getting that phone call was actually very funny. I pulled over on the side of the road, and it was David Courier who gave me the message. And he said, "Hi, this is Dave Courier. We screened Blackfish, and we're very honored to be able to screen this at Park City in January. Things move very fast from here on in. You know, you need to get us a synopsis." And I was like, did the film get into Sundance? Like, I needed that sentence with those words and that pattern, because I guess I maybe had dreamed about it, you know, and hearing it, and I needed it said that way, or I didn't believe it. Like, can you just say it again? Because, like, I think I might need to scream. I'm one of those. And so he was like, I'm sorry, of course, no. I forget that it's when it's your first time, you need to scream. So.
And still, it seems like it's more than you're expected even then.
Oh, God.
I mean, last night your enthusiasm was just bubbling over.
Oh, was it okay?
Usually, sometimes the documentarians get up there and they're kind of, you know, very pointed and direct and cold. And,
right,
you know,
right. No.
Okay, we're here. Hope you like the movie.
No, like, no. I'm just like, got, you know, ready to go to the prom, like bubbling over with teenage excitement. Like, I can't be cool. I try so hard, but I can't be cool.
So why did you become a documentarian in the first place?
I remember I was in Guatemala. I was like getting my graduate degree in political science, and took a trip to Guatemala and remember seeing this woman with a camera and like a backpack, and she was like filming these kids on the street, and she was you know, talking to them and sort of interviewing them, and I just remember like that's like a cooler version of myself right there, you know, like that's kind of who. Like I want to be, you know, taking those kinds of risks and, you know, and creating something. And I don't want to live in sort of a safe, predictable world. You know, I want to go out and kind of discover things.
Well, documentarian would be the least safe, predictable world.
I know. Yeah, and I've always been sort of comfortable with the future being a question mark. Mm-hmm. So like this fits me a bit. But to be able to maybe do something good, maybe, and tell a story that sort of needs to be told. That was kind of the icing, you know, that's the icing on the cake.
So was the film of it intimidating, or was that...
Filming this?
Well, no, just filming in general for you. The idea of becoming, actually putting a documentary on film from the first time you did it, was that something that was a blockade, or was that just something like, okay, I can handle that?
Oh, yeah, I think that's interesting, an interesting question. I've never been worried about screening a film or putting it out there, having it on TV.
Or no, shooting, I mean.
Shooting itself?
Production.
Yeah, that's where you were.
Because you weren't in film school. You were in
Follow-Side. I was not in film school. I'd never picked up a camera before I started becoming a documentarian. I didn't have any training or anything. I interned and all that stuff. It was totally terrifying. It's still more, you know, I mean, you get used to doors being shut in your face. You get used to being hung up on. You get used to even having your crew, like, sort of not knowing what it is you're trying to do. Do you know what I mean? And you're just sort of, like, you're out there. It's very, very lonely. It's really weird. I mean, you can have a crew and you can be drinking at night, but, you know, and that's all fun. But, you know, that your creative process or where you're going with this film and not being sure where you're going with this film and having that kind of insecurity is all your own. And you sort of carry that with you through production. I mean, I think it incentivizes you to start making sense of a script in your head so that you're not just lost, but you can be lost. I mean, you can just be out there just shooting and just not having kind of a final end date or an end goal. Mm-hmm. Kind of terrifying, you know?
So where do you tend to find it? Do you find it at the end of that process, in the middle of that process? Do you lock in at some point?
I found it in chunks. So I found, I knew my opening, you know, after my third interview, I had my opening, you know, and I was like, that's my opening. I don't really care. I don't really care what movie I make. It's just, I want that to be my, you know.
Right.
Then I had, about 3 months in, I had my ending, you know, because I was like, okay, this is cathartic. I see the trainers as being my apostles, and they're kind of delivering a message from the dark side, you know, and they're delivering this message. I guess to me, to the world. And so in a way at the end, I need to allow them to sort of be released or, you know, and the way they spoke and the way their interviews were kind of confessionals in a way. So I said, that was sort of my arc, was starting with the glory of becoming a trainer, you know, and then seeing Wild Wales and that glory, you know, and the difference of those. And so I sort of, that arc carried me. Once I met the trainers, that was my arc, you know? So that was kind of...
And do you have it sounds like you don't have a call to action almost intentionally by the end of the picture, but just assume that people will take from it what they will and that's how they will go on with their lives?
Yeah, I kind of wanted to remain a bit humble, I think, about my... what my sights, you know, where to set my sights. I wanted to, you know, remind myself that I'm a storyteller that I'm a filmmaker. I will do that the best that I can, and as, you know, hopefully powerfully as I can, but very honestly, and provide a document, you know? And in a way, I feel like if I pretend to know more than I do, and I start answering questions about orcas in the wild, all I'm doing is parroting on the work of others. And so, you know, I just kind of want to know my place. That's number one. Mm. Number two, I feel like what I want from the film is for it, I think I said this last night, is, you know, we all sort of feel something about these parks, you know, whether you're disgusted by them or whether you just think it's a little weird or whether you just don't care. I just hope that this document has a chance, because it's so honest and fact-based, of giving you kind of, I guess, arming you with information, you know, and so that you can either articulate how you feel a little bit better, or that you are just a actively thinking consumer. So you make that decision to throw down that $100 bill to go there. You know what you're seeing. You know what you're getting when you go in there. So you're just, I think it should be an active decision, not a passive one.